And hello, everyone. I hope we can get our our intro. There we go. Okay, I think I stopped it because I always do this wrong, Norman. But I'm gonna remove it. That way I know it's gone because I always do it. Well, hello everybody, and you know that's not Georgia. This is Norman again from the Ultimate Fashion History, who is gracing us with his presence for another How Betty Davis Saved My Life: Life Lessons from Classic Hollywood. We are so happy to you could join us today. I am Moya, and I'll let this man introduce himself.
Hi, I'm Norman, and it's really nice to be back. I can't wait to talk about some of the things we're going to talk about today. So let's have at it.
Yes. So our movie today is Shadow of a Doubt from Alfred Hitchcock. And of course, we're going back in time like we always do with our movies. And I cannot wait to get into this with Norman. But before we get into that, Norman, you started, so it's been about 3 weeks, I think, since we were together, and shout out to Tom and the rest of the UFH crew and all the wonderful Facebook pages that we are a part of. But it's about 3 weeks, and you did something in 2 weeks.
No, I just thought I was going to start a page that was going to be more focused on sort of like the posts that I do on Ultimate Fashion History that just kind of focused on like Friday film fashion kind of segment. I've been kind of negligent about really keeping it up, but you know, it's kind of fun to, you know, when you first get started, it takes a little bit of momentum, and I'm just not really good at promoting anything right now. But yeah, it's been kind of fun. It's basically a riff off of what I already do on Ultimate Fashion History. There's nothing earth shattering here, but I do love fashion. I love costumes in fashion movies and in the history and stuff like that. So it's just a forum for me to play.
And I don't know why it's not showing your latest post, but and you are preaching to the choir. I am the worst at social media and promotion. I totally suck. And apologies to our audience and the people who follow us. Yeah, I wish we would post more. But I direct you to the Ultimate Fashion History and Norman's page, because look at this. I wonder what it let me. Well, first of all, those of you who listen to us on audio only, hello to you. And what we're looking at right now is Norman's Facebook page, Film Fashion Fridays. And I don't know why it's not updating. I don't want to mess it up. But if you go there, he's also posted some beautiful clothes by Grace Kelly. And who was the designer for her?
For whom?
For Grace Kelly. And because you had some of her movies and
Oh yeah. That was for, I believe, Dial M for Murder. It was an English gentleman. Okay. And I'm gonna have to look it up. I'm sorry, I forgot that. But that Grace Kelly in that Dial M for Murder has a great orangey red dress that just looks fantastic on her. And part of it is because it's supposed to symbolize the fact that she has been an adulteress, and that's what kind of sparked off everything. Right. So the color of the dress really has a lot to do with the plot and the point of the thing. So I kind of like that kind of stuff, you know?
Absolutely. And I think you also also posted some stuff from High Society, that lavender. Well, it looked lavender to me, that lavender gown she had on, and that just absolutely beautiful. And I don't know why my thing, maybe if I update it later. But so he has Grace Kelly's outfits from some of her movies is on there. But we're looking at his post with the one and only Vivian Leigh when she was in Anna Karenina. And I love that story, period. I saw it with Garbo, and then yeah. I saw it with Vivian Leigh.
Yeah.
And the clothes, oh my gosh. Look at these clothes, the just mountains of or what do they call that?
Not ruching, I think.
Ruching and organza, is that
yeah. Yeah. And this is Cecil Beaton. Cecil Beaton was like the, you know, famous art director in the 30s, multiple awards. I think one of the last things he did was My Fair Lady, which was you know, obviously fantastic. So he had a long, successful career doing this. And you can tell, you can see why.
And we rarely talk about jewels. Not that we don't want to talk about jewels, but right here, the jewels are being showcased. So for those of you who are listening, the audio, Vivian Lee's Anna Karenina has this pearl choker on. And Norma, you probably know this. The studios, they would sometimes get real stuff because the director, they were like authenticity, right?
No, they would often rent them, you know, and it also would be like kind of advertising, you know, for the stores. Obviously, it's kind of like product placement. But they also had warehouses full of like sets and things, you know, they were making movies for quite some time. So they had, you know, they had costume stuff too. So, but I think here they definitely went out and rented that at, you know, Winston's or whoever. Yeah.
And it's unfortunate when a studio collapsed, the studio system collapsed. A lot of the stuff either got lost or auctioned and then they had a fire and a lot of these beautiful gowns and costumes just got lost or destroyed. And can you believe that?
I know. Well, briefly, we should mention that for a little bit of time, Debbie Reynolds had a curating a lot of these things, a lot of Hollywood stuff, and had a museum for a brief moment in time. I don't think she was able to run very long with it. I don't think it was profitable, and it didn't last. But she was really valiantly trying to, you know, collect and save and archive a lot of this stuff. So,
okay, well, kudos to her, the late great Debbie Reynolds. Kudos to her. And so now we are going to get to Shadow of a Doubt. But so when I was asking Norma to join me in Georgia's stead, you know, we were going back, what movies she was in? I didn't want to send Norman like 30, 40 movies. I said, all right, pick one. He's like, oh, are you kidding? So we narrowed it down to Film Noir, Shadow of a Doubt. Then Norma's like, Norma's like, well, let's do Double Indemnity. It's like, oh man, we did that one already. I said, but I'll talk about it again. And you know, Hitchcock did not do both of these movies, you know, those of us who know, but we just, I wanted to get a male's point of view about Double Indemnity, and especially Walter Neff's character, Fred McMurray. So for those of you, just real quickly, Norman, just tell them what Double Indemnity is about, if for those who don't know what it is.
Yeah, so Fred McMurray plays a insurance salesman who's, you know, a little shady, not completely stand upright guy, and he gets involved with a woman who has an unfortunate husband who's kind of in the way, and she gets the idea that, you know, maybe they can together off her husband and you know, do a little insurance scam, and it goes south from there, as you might predict. So yeah,
and Norman is so, he makes it sound like, oh, it's just a walk in the park.
Yeah,
or nothing.
It's a dark movie. It's a dark movie.
Nothing to see here. Yeah. But no, it's super, super, super dark. And so, Norman, I forgot to ask you: had you ever seen McMurray? And McMurray plays an awesome villain. I wish he'd have played more villains.
Well, when I first saw this movie when I was a kid, I had known him as the dad for my three sons.
Absolutely, all of us. And plumber and an absent-minded professor.
So at that point he had like this goofy kind of like dad, you know, persona. So when I saw this movie, I thought, first of all, like, he was kind of hot. Like, you know, and I think that well, he really is. I mean, like, he's you know, a young man here. He's like in his early 30s. I think he kind of works this sort of Lothario thing very well. It was a surprise to me to see this other dimension to him.
So I was getting to the point. So another time he played a villain was in Pushover with Kim Novak, like about maybe almost 10 years later or something like that, 17 years later. Have you seen that?
I haven't. I think I did see him in a movie where he plays like a really mean, like, executive, like in the 50s.
Yes, The Apartment, he did.
Oh my God, yes.
Wasn't he good? I mean, he plays an awesome villain.
Yeah, he does. He had more range than I had originally given him credit.
And it's not the same guy. They're all three of these guys are horrible people, right. But he does not play them the same. And I'm glad you brought that up. Him in the apartment, he should have gotten up. He may have gotten an Oscar nod, I don't know, but he should have won, in my opinion, because it played so against type, and he was an absolute heel in the apartment. I loved it.
Yeah, he was brutal. And in you know, this movie, Double Indemnity, you know, even his name, like Walter Neff, it's just, it kind of gives you a hint that, you know, it's just a funny name, you know, and it just kind of like, he kind of does this job of playing really kind of like a low-heeled kind of guy. I don't know how to describe it better than that. But, he's kind of a scrounger.
So tell me, what did you think about, I guess you already told me, but the dynamic with him and Phyllis, Barbara Stanwyck's character, as a man.
Yeah.
Did you think, this is what I want to ask you. Who was in control? Who was really in control? As a man, did you feel some kind of way like, oh man, you punk, or you know, man, you're weak? Or did you feel like, hey, he is just a dude being a dude? I mean, what did you think?
She worked him from the get-go. No, I really do. I think she just kind of reeled him in and had him thinking he was, you know, working, you know, calling the shots. But I think I think the thing that's most interesting about her is a couple things. You know, it's Barbara Stanwyck. The first time we see her, she's actually naked. She's covered in a towel, and she's like, oh my goodness. And then, you know, she comes down the stairs and she's still putting on her blouse. She's still kind of like, you know, arranging herself. And at the time, this was considered like really loosey-goosey kind of behavior. Yes. And then you've got that wig, which is an obvious cheap wig.
Yes.
And obvious and cheap is what she is. So that wig is, when I first saw the movie, I was like, why did they put that wig on?
Yes. Yeah.
It's such a terrible choice, you know. It's just, it doesn't look good on her. It's actually kind of goofy. But
in a picture of it,
when you think about it as something that's both obvious and cheap, it just tells you everything you need to know about her.
Yes. And,
you know, I think there are hints that she also may have had something to do with the demise of her now husband's previous wife that was in the way. So you kind of get the hint that she's just a roller. She's been doing this for a while.
Right.
And he just kind of is a hapless kind of guy. He's like a real neph. He just kind of wanders into it and gets spit up and chewed out. And yeah.
Yeah. I mean, so that's what I wanted to know. Or did you, that's why I wanted to get a guy's opinion, because I don't want to spoil it for everybody, because I was about to ask you, did you think she really cared about him? But don't answer that. We can answer that off camera, because a lot of people may have not seen this. But if you're a film noir or Stanwyck or McMurray fan, you have seen this movie more than once. So I know I'm not spoiling it. But
it's really worth seeing. If people haven't seen it, I would just like stop listening right now and just watch it. It's really worth it. It's a dark movie. You got to be strapped in for something dark and something noir, and nobody's nice, and
no one's nice.
It's a really cynical worldview, but it's classic.
And I love to look at the foreign movie posters. And yes, Edward G. What did you think about Edward G? We're going to get to Shadow of a Doubt, guys, I promise.
This is, he had spent the previous decade being the number one bad guy. He was a bad gangster. So at this point in his career, he's playing like, you know, uncles and dads and wise, you know, soft men. And he's really good in that movie against Joan Bennett, where he's just like a simpleton and she just ropes him in. And so he's at this point in his career where he's kind of softening. He's you know, and he's really charming in this movie. I think that the relationship between the two men is just so sweet and so honest, and they really care about each other. That really comes across. Here's the wig. Now the wig that looks terrible. I mean, it looks ridiculous.
It's so bad.
And look how she's got the glasses like over the wig, which is, I've never seen anybody do that in real life.
But that's a little red flag right there. Okay, let me leave.
Anybody else would run, but Walter Ness is like intrigued. So that's what you need to know.
Because he was cheap. You said it. He was low heel. He was a cheap, smarmy so-and-so. Yeah. And so that's why they got with each other.
Yeah.
And they just were talking about what they were going to do to her husband as if they was ordering from the food menu.
That's right.
Like nothing. But so this is one of the iconic scenes. And I don't want to give away too much, but she says one of the lines. And I think she was nominated for this. But like I said, I think one time we were commenting on UFH's page. How did this woman, who did she offend? Who hated her in Hollywood? How in the world did she not win a competitive Oscar just for this alone? Because she set the tone for femme fatales after this.
Yeah. She was definitely robbed, but
several times.
What a great actress! She was another one who I believe was an independent as well. I don't think she was associated with a particular studio, so that gave her a lot of range. Quite a bit of stuff, so that's terrific.
Well, that's probably
was in the beginning, but
I think that's probably was the part of it. Part of it. She may have been shaded, low key shaded, or blackballed. You know, they couldn't stop her from being a star because people loved her. She's another one who rarely made a bad film.
Yeah.
And even if the film wasn't that good, she was still great in it. So she was a star. They couldn't stop her. You know,
I would say that, you know, looking back on her movies now, they age a lot better than some of the ones that are in the top, you know, five that you usually go to. Like, her movies still hold up in a way that some of the other ones really, you know, just don't for various reasons. So
absolutely. No, I totally agree. Yeah. Okay, guys, here we are. Oh, we're ready for that's the movie we're supposed to be doing today. Shadow of a Doubt.
That was just an appetizer.
All right. So this is 1943, Shadow of a Doubt. And Norman, go ahead, and I'm going to queue up some photos, and you can go ahead on and get us started.
So the movie, it's a Hitchcock movie. It's shot in 1943. It's set in a you know, lovely middle America, on the West Coast, but you know, definitely middle class America values, and just charming family, and there is a young daughter in the family who's just kind of bored, and she wishes for her Uncle Charlie to come back, and she's actually named for Uncle Charlie, and they seem to have this bond that's really quite sweet, and then Uncle Charlie comes, and things are not quite what they seem to be when Uncle Charlie shows up, well, I guess I'll stop there for now.
So we'll just give you a little background. Of course, this is Hitchcock. Hitchcock had been in the movies now because he kind of started off in Silence, silent era. And so he had been maybe going on 20 years, maybe not quite, but almost 20 years. And so, Norman, let me ask you this, because we know when you say Hitchcock, you think of Birds. But first think of Psycho, then Birds. Do you think Shadow of a Doubt gets lost in the sauce?
It may. It's not as flashy. It was very well received when it came out. It was very, very well enjoyed and well viewed. He had only been working in the United States for a couple of years. I think his first movie for the Selznick Studios was Rebecca.
Okay.
And then he did Suspicion the next year. So he's still pretty new in the game in America, and still, kind of establishing himself. And this movie really put him, was really well regarded.
And so I am kind of spoiling it just a hair. Now, we saw it for free. I saw it for free on Tubi. I don't know where Norman saw it, but I saw it for free on Tubi, and I think it's some other places. But yeah, so if you have that app, go and look at that. And I'm kind of jumping ahead, Norman, what I have on the screen.
Yeah.
But we saw Joseph Cotten. So let me go back and pull up Teresa Wright, a picture of her. So I don't know. Do you know anything? Do you have anything about Teresa Wright?
So she's another one who I think, today is not as well remembered. But this woman, in her first three movies, got Oscar nominations.
Sure did.
And so she, I think when you watch her now, she just seems so kind of natural.
Yes.
And she kind of, clearly what she was doing was appealing to people because she was getting nominations at that caliber mm-hmm. from the very beginning of her career. And I think this movie gives you a great example of what people saw in her. She was very believable, very, very, you know, this movie's really supposed to be about like sort of American middle-class values. And she just is right there. She just seems to be the girl that you would see next door.
Right.
You know, but, you know, there's a lot there. She was very intelligent as well. Mm-hmm. Beautiful woman. Beautiful. And yeah, did a really, you know, great job in the movies. Can't argue with that.
And she actually for Miss Miniver, right? Mrs. Miniver, right?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. So she was in Pride of the Yankees. She was in Mrs. Miniver. She was in this. So she was in, you know, pretty stellar movies right from the get-go. She didn't have like a, you know, a seedling time. She just went right into the deep water. So, and did very well.
And she held her own because I first knew of her in The Little Foxes, of course, with
my girl.
Our namesake. And Norman, we'll have to get you to come back because of course we did that movie, but we're going to get you to come back and revisit The Little Foxes with us. I could look at that like once a month.
Oh, I know. I don't want to get derailed.
No, you're right. But this is what Norman was talking about. And when we were prepping for the show, that Norman Rockwell type of vibe in this all American town. Mm-hmm. And so the town and the people, they were like almost another character too.
Right. And, you know, I was saying earlier before we started that, you know, this came out like smack dab in the middle of World War II. The war itself does not enter into the story world, but I think that's what appealed to people, that it presented this ideal Norman Rockwell kind of vision of you know what people aspire to, but also Hitchcock being Hitchcock, he had to throw a monkey wrench in there and just kind of show you that there's a dark side to everything, and that's where the movie gets really cooking when we get into that more darker
right
underneath the surface. Yeah.
So this is Hitchcock in this era, and this is him, I suppose, doing something on a set. So, and it's funny to see like quote unquote a younger Hitchcock because he has black hair and everything. He's still, you know, portly or what have you. But yeah, so this is that era. And so let's get a little bit into the plot. Well, let's talk about Joseph Cotten. I know you want to talk about the supporting cast. What do you have for us about Joseph Cotten?
He was pretty terrific. I think he's best remembered for, he was in The Third Man. He was in Citizen Kane, which was like a, you know, big production at the time. I believe he was also an independent. I don't know if he was associated with the studio, but, you know, always played these kind of suave kind of guys with just a little bit of grit underneath them. And in this movie, I think he's really allowed to kind of showcase both the charming side, which is, you know, important to his character to be charming, and also this darker side that really is perfect for this movie, because this movie really does, you know, show both, you know, the charm and the underbelly. And so I think he's perfect in this movie.
And he was, he cut his teeth on the stage, if you will. He was a stand-in for Melvin Douglas and on some stage work. And we know, and then he eventually hooked up with Orson Welles, like you mentioned a minute ago. And so these were powerhouse actors. And this movie, to me, I wish it would get mentioned more with Hitchcock stuff, because it seems understated. So let's try to give a little bit of the plot without giving it away. So go ahead, Norman, and I'll cue up some photos for us.
So there's some question about, you know, when we first see Uncle Charlie, he's kind of living a bit on the skids. And, you know, but when he shows up to town, he presents as this really affluent guy. You know, he's spending money all over the place. He's, you know, wanting to, he's given, you know, gifts, you know, very expensive gifts, but he's, you know, if you look at the picture there, he's living in a room. He's rented a room.
Right.
You know, he's really on the skids. He's on the skids, and he's also seemingly on the run because mm-hmm. he's got people following him. And so we don't know why he's, you know, pretending to be this rich guy. We don't know why he's on the run, why people are looking for him, but there is this sort of murder case that's going on. Manhunt is going on for this guy called the Merry Widow Killer. And so it's assumed that, you know, he might have something to do with that.
And so he goes to his, probably one of the last resorts to his sister, to go live with a visit, quote unquote, his sister. But like you said, is he really visiting or is he hiding out? And so let's talk about the supporting characters from the children who were, I'm like, kids ain't really like that. Like, so if I had to nitpick, how they made the little girl, the little baby sister, like, sure, ain't really like that, but it was funny, I guess, you know?
Yeah. I mean, yeah.
He, supporting cast.
He didn't really like kids.
Are you talking about Hitchcock?
No, I don't think Hitchcock really, you know, understood kids, you know, and I think he just didn't know how to use them in movies really well. And here's an example. I mean, she's cute. She's adorable. It's, you know, she's on the phone, but she doesn't even wait for the person to respond, like, you know, even pretend that, like, there's somebody on the other end of the phone. She just kind of recites her lines very well. You know, she's good. I mean, there's really no reason. I mean, plot-wise, there's really no reason for these two kids to be there. But they just
saying the same thing.
They do sort of fill out the family idea, you know, mm-hmm. a big family, a big house, you know.
And the parents were too old to have had this because the mom, I mean, will show her in the middle. I'll find a picture. I'm like, you know, y'all were grandparents.
Well, they probably, you know, they were probably only meant to be like 35, you know.
Go stand up and sit down. No, no.
They do look a lot older than they.
Yeah, here's dad.
Yeah, I mean, that's what's his name? Henry Travers? Is Harry Travers? Henry, who's best known as the Angel.
And
It's a Wonderful Life. Right. He's adorable. But, you know, I think, like, if Teresa Wright's character is just 20 years old, mm-hmm. so they might be 40. These people might be 40, 45 at most.
Yeah, and they still look super old. But, you know, people looked, we talked about this before, looked so old back then. Yeah. You know?
Yeah. And then the mother is Patricia.
Is there any Coolidge? Not Coolidge. It sounds like that. Coolidge.
Who's just brilliant. And she does kind of play this kind of, ditzy.
College. There we go.
Yeah, and she's quite, and that's a very matronly, you know, she's very played up to be this matronly mm-hmm. character. She was also brilliant. Her and Teresa Wright would be paired up earlier in The Little Foxes together.
Yes.
Yep.
Yeah, and she plays such a tragic figure, and she wasn't tragic here, but we knew because of the foreshadowing. You know, Hitchcock was a master at foreshadowing that she was going to take something tragically, you know, and so this poor woman never had any happiness in movies, poor thing. But perfectly cast. Once again, these are one of these movies that where the cast is absolutely perfect. And I totally appreciate that.
Talk for a minute about the next door neighbor, Hume Cronin, who just
plays.
He's an odd duck, too. I mean,
I was wondering. And he later becomes a pivotal plot device. But I was wondering, what the heck are you doing there?
Well, I think it introduces, so it's kind of funny because the father and the next door neighbor are fascinated with true crime and murder. Yeah. And it's sort of like Hitchcock's kind of wink to like that true crime fascination. But when the crime is actually in your own home, that's a different story. You know, it's an enjoyable thing to kind of, and they tease each other like they're going to, you know, pretending to kill each other. And then they have this whole thing going on. But it's all a joke. It's entertainment. And then, you know, the fact of the matter, the actual crime, true crime is a much more different thing.
Right. And I'm trying to say we don't have unfortunately have a picture of Hume Cronin and it's so funny, him and his wife, real life wife, Jessica Tandy, they became famous
Yeah.
Way later in their careers. I mean, I think Tandy like died not long after she won for Best Actress for Driving Miss Daisy. So endurance. So we know Hume Cronin, he really became the prominence in Cocoon. And we plan on doing Cocoon, guys. That is on a list of movies to do. I don't have a picture of him, but yeah, he was so quirky and weird. But again, later on, he became a huge part of the plot twist, if you will. No, I don't have a picture of him. We are almost out of time. But please go and watch Shadow of a Doubt. And we didn't talk too much about the fashion because it was pretty straightforward, wasn't it, Norman?
Yeah, I think fashion-wise, it's not gonna, you know, spark anything, but it's very everyday. You know, if you want to know what everyday people wore, this will be right up your alley. It's very it's like a slice of ideal Americana, and yes. I think that's interesting to think about in the context of the fact that, you know, we were in the midst of, you know, World War at the time, and what it meant to people to see this movie at the time, and why it was so popular.
Absolutely. So if you're a Hitchcock fan and you don't want, you know, you want to see something different and gore and just something like, if you didn't know it was him, because this is one of the few movies he doesn't appear, because usually he would make a cameo and if you blinked, you missed him.
So he's on the train.
He is. I missed him.
he never misses an opportunity. He's on the train when Uncle Charlie is on his way to go see them.
Santa
Rosa, he's got his back to the camera and he's playing cards and he's holding holding like a winning hand.
Out of here. I totally missed that. Okay, now I gotta go back and find. It's like, where's Waldo? Where's Hitchcock? Yeah,
exactly. There he is. And I want to say that too, you know, the movie is very dark as well. I mean, it starts off with this beautiful, you know, ideal imagery, but it definitely presents a darker side to things. And the idea that Uncle Charlie might be this murderer really gets under Teresa Wright's skin and really starts to work through the rest of the movie. So it's Hitchcock. There's going to be tension. There's going to be suspense. Mm-hmm. It's not, you know, it's not a Norman Rockwell painting at all.
No, it is not. Yeah. And he has a thing for trains because he has several of his movies and the train is really a huge device in a lot of his movies, which is fascinating. So if you're a train enthusiast, you know, definitely look at this.
Those old trains, they were so beautiful.
Weren't they? And I mean, when you travel on a train back in the day, I mean, it was class. You know, you could have it was different classes, literally. But you could really travel in style back in those days with the train. So guys, just check out Shadow of a Doubt. Let us know what you think in the comments. You know, do you agree with us? You disagree? Or let us know, do you have a different experience when you watch the movie? And especially, what did you think about Joseph Cotten in this really dark turn? Did you know what was going to happen? Because I had seen it before. Norman, both of us had seen it before. I hadn't seen it in a long time, but Norman has seen it several times. I only had seen it once before. And when I first looked at it, I had no idea. I kind of, you know, you kind of think, but I'm going to stop talking, but look at it. Cause you are sucked into this movie. Aren't you, Norman? You are in the movie with these people. I know I was.
Yeah. And I think part of that is the great casting. You know, Hitchcock, you know, he thought, like, you know, his entire movie was planned out before he even ran a shot. He thought, like, you know, he did the back work, he did the story, the plot, and then he decided to hire like the best people to play the roles. And he basically let them do what they did. He apparently, most actors said, he was kind of hands off. Like, he had planned already in his head, and as long as you did, you know, what he asked you to do, he was fine. And I think that he got some very natural performances out of these people, and I think that's what helps you get sucked in, because they seem, you know, pretty, except for the little girl who's just terrible. They seem like a real. They seem like real people. They seem like people that, you know, you could be interested in what's going on with them.
So, guys, we're going to stop it right there. Thank you so much. Go ahead, Norman. I'm sorry.
I should say, anytime. Thank you.
Don't forget to hit us up on Facebook. We really appreciate you. Shout out to Ultimate Fashion History, the William Powell and Myrna Lloyd, the Fred McMurray fan page, the Betty Davis fan page, and Joan Crawford, and so many, many, many more. Let's keep these movies alive. You guys take care. We'll see you next time.
Bye-bye.